All right, good morning. We're going to try to get started here. I'd like to welcome you and have a word of prayer if I could. We're glad that you came. Father, we thank you today for the privilege of being in the house of the Lord, and we thank you for the privilege of honoring and being a part of this family. Lord, these servants of yours, and Lord, Father, we pray, Father, for this service, that it'll be a blessing to this family, and Lord, honor the memory that has been left behind. We ask you, Father, to honor this young man who's he comes to sing, and Lord, let your grace be upon him. In Jesus' name, amen. Jason?
Coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, and no more tears to dim the eye. Holy Spirit, on that happy golden shore, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will. There'll be no sorrows there, and no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no more pain, and no more partings over there, and forever. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. When he takes me by that will be.
Great song, great song. I kind of want to set the stage here today with what we're here for. Of course, we're here to remember a couple that had been married a long time and seemed to die not very far apart. And we just want to lift them before you today and highlight their life a little bit. One of the great things we're doing as a memorial service is, of course, memorializing or establishing a memory that we've made, celebrating the life of Nell and Robert and their life together and the legacy that they have created. And so today I want to try to focus a little bit on them without question, all right? Start with Mom, Miss Nell. Miss Nell Catherine McCoin, age 71, of Elkton, Maryland, passed away on November 15, 2020. She was born on March the 4th, 1949, in Grundy, Virginia, to the late Jeff Evans Yates and Willie Leona Charles Yates. Nell was a person with a humble heart, a person who loved the Lord and loved God with all of her heart and other people as well, which comes together, of course. Nell was an artist, loved to paint, and we see some paintings up here that Miss Nell painted. She also enjoyed learning to play musical instruments, such as piano and violin. And that's neither one of them very easy to play, so it says a whole lot about her. Miss Nell also loved flowers, enjoyed working with plants. And so we celebrate her life today. And I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and read Robert's statement, and then we'll put both of those family units together with their legacy, all right? Mr. Robert Lee McCoin, Sr., age 70, of Elkton, Maryland, passed away on Thursday, September 9, 2021. Was born on February 17, 1951, in Elkton, Maryland, to the late Cecil Kyle McCoin and Emma Louise Allie McCoin. Robert enjoyed fishing, watching westerns, baseball, especially the Phillies. He loved to play pool, having played in tournaments and won. Robert was a loving husband, father, grandfather. He will be remembered as a fighter to the end. And he will be dearly missed, just like Miss Nell will. Their family, as they leave behind, they're survived. Of course, Miss Nell was married to Robert for 52 years. And, of course, vice versa there. They're a couple, and they're the one who started it all. And so we rejoice in their marriage and the many years that they were married, because that's not easy to say, 52 years. But she's also, and he's also survived by Susan McCoin and Willie Louise Wirtz, married to Dallas. Son Robert McCoin Jr., married to Kimberly. Curtis McCoin, married to Annette. And Danny Ray McCoin. And sisters Del Crook, Della Crook, Shelba, how you say that, Rob? Shelby, I'm sorry. You told me that a while ago and I didn't get it right yet. Shelby Conover and brothers Danny, David, Jeff Yates, 8 grandchildren, Blake McCoin, James McCoin, Hannah Donaldson, Connor now, Curtis McCoin, and Katie, of course is his sweetheart and wife, Matthew McCoin, Dylan Wirtz, Haley Wirtz, Nolan Wirtz, and 2 great-grandchildren, Emma and Bo Donaldson. And, of course, both Nell and Robert is very proud of their family, I'm sure. And so today we celebrate their life and their legacy that has gone on for quite a few years, and now they've gone on to the next phase in their life, and we're going to honor them today with 2 things, and this is what we're about to do, okay? We're going to bring Susan up, and ask Susan to sing for us. And then after Susan sings, we're going to get you, some of you, if you want, desire to say something about Nell and Robert, that you would be willing to do that, even if we bring the mic to you. So Susan, come on up. All right. That will be fine.
See yonder through the breath of earth, the sight my heart entrances forevermore. Jehovah's band of ever faithful warriors, unity advances, helmets do fly. Their helmets bright against the sky, big ignorance and error do fly. They shout aloud their battle cry. Christ reigns on earth, receive him from high. Kiss the sun, let Jehovah be angry, and you never perish along in the way. Happy are they that do put their trust ever in him today. The King Christ Jesus leads the way. His leadership they follow and they carry through. He speaks the word and they now obey. And thus it's bet nor pain nor sorrow for I. They wield their sword, the word of God. Their feet are ever with the good news shod. They walk the way their master trod. Clear to the death they follow forevermore. Kiss the sun, let Jehovah be angry, and you never perish along in the way. Happy are they that do put their trust ever in him today. For see, the time has come now at last for Christ to reign in power from on high. Soon all his foes shall ever lick the dust. Before him they must cower, for I, his God Jehovah, bears his arm. His trumpet ever sounds that loud alarm. Be wise, you rulers, never do no harm. Your judges on Christ's power from above. Kiss the sun, let Jehovah be angry, and you never perish along in the way. Happy are they that do put their trust ever in him today. All right. Thank you. All right, I got another one too. Let's see. The stars that fill the summer night look down from above. The beauty of the earth and sky you fashion with love. Your hands prepare the land and sea and everything that came to be. Brought joy to your life. There is joy in your creation, in the message of salvation and the paradise to come. But to have your love forever is the real and lasting treasure. You alone will prove to be our joy eternally. The things we feel and touch and feel deep inside. The beauty of a youthful heart that steams from deep inside. You gave us such a perfect start, eternity in every heart. And joy in our lives. There is joy in your creation, in the message of salvation and the paradise to come. But to have your love forever is the real and lasting treasure. You alone will prove to be our joy eternally. The joy cannot be ours without the gift of your Son. He paid the ransom sacrifice so joy could be ours for all time ever to come. There is joy in your creation, in the message of salvation and the paradise to come. But to have your love forever is the real and lasting treasure. You alone will prove to be our joy eternally. You alone could prove to be our joy eternally.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Miss Susan. That's not easy singing without music. You did good. She said she wanted a full band, but I said I don't have one today. I try to get these McCoin boys up there on those instruments, but there's only thing up there is a drum and a piano. But they could have played it. Hey. You did good. You did good. All right, this is a time that we're going to give you an opportunity to share if you'd like to share. You know, I know that it's hard to speak on the mic, and it's hard to come in front of everybody, so that's the reason I'm going to come down here, and if you want to speak on the mic and say something about Neil and Mr. Robert, you can do so, and I'll bring it to you. Maybe it's a special story, special something. I've got something that Robert wrote up for me, Robert Jr., but I want to read that in a minute. But some of you might want to share something as well. Special memory? Well, hang on. Logan. Hang on. He's upstairs. He's got a song.
I remember when Grandma used to always play baseball with us, and she always taught us how to paint, and then she always took us back and taught us how to really plant and take care of plants. And Grandpa one time went with us to a baseball game, and he was funny.
I just wanted to say that I know this is a bad time with this coronavirus and all, and with people dying, and there is something more seem to be going on than a drop of a hat. All I think about is that I love the scene, and that I just feel bad that doors seem to be shut on me because of me being disabled before work. Well, I was just explaining.
This is not talking about mom and dad.
Well, I'm in pain here. I lost my mom and dad. But all I remember are things, and I can't change it. I can't. I wish I could. But that's why I want to say is that I'm sorry this bad time had happened, and I wish I could change it. And I never wanted this to happen. And there is something more going on than drop of a hat if people are dying. I can't go for that. I can't go for that.
Thank you for sharing, girl. All right.
During the last few months of my dad's life, he came to live with us. And I learned things about my dad I never actually knew before. Like his favorite food was Burger King Junior Whoppers with no pickles and Hershey Sunday pies. And one night, Dallas was making his famous lasagna. And Hammer didn't know this at the point. And he says, "Willie, go get me a Junior Whopper with no pickles and a Hershey pie." And I said, "Ham, are you sure you want that? Dallas is making his famous lasagna." And then Dad's eyes became as wide as saucers. He was like, "Ooh."
Well, that's good to know. All right. It's amazing how different people are.
Dad used to take us to Indian River, and we'd go fishing there, and we got skunked so many times there. Did we ever catch anything there?
Well, we had one of the baits we used got bit in half, and we saw the bait.
Yeah, I mean, it was so absurd, because we would be out there all day, and then And we were fishing with live spot, right, Pastor? And Dad had his hook through the nose. And something with a lot of teeth hit this fish. And the pole went down, right? And Ham was like, "Oh!" And he grabbed it. And the fish was bit off right behind the hook, and you can see the teeth marks. But, you know, we loved them things. Our dad was good to us, man, like that. You know, we did dad things, dad kid things with Dad. You know, there
you go. That's great. That's great. Everybody don't have that, brother. Yeah. Anybody else? I don't want to cut you off, man. All right. Well, that was good. That was good.
Well, you know, I do have a letter here that Rob wrote, Robert Jr., about Mom and Dad. That's always good because it gives you time to think. Our mom and dad were not perfect parents, but who is? They loved us, they loved their children, and we loved them. They were there for us and each other, even when half of all other marriages ended in broken homes. Staying power says much about their character. I thank God that He gave us to them to raise. We love them dearly and will bear their loss with heavy hearts on into the future. I want to show appreciation to Aunt Bella Crook, Uncle Dick, Aunt Shelby. You all took care of my mom at the end, and I thank God for you all and everything you did to care for Mom and Aunt Debbie. I would also like to acknowledge my sister, Willie, her husband, Dallas, their children, Aunt Linda Horn, for taking care of Dad when he could not manage. Special thanks to Danny, to Curtis, to Annette, or Anita. Is that Annette? Annette, I got it right the first time, didn't I? My loving wife, Kimberly, for all you did to take care of Mom and Dad. Whether it was cooking meals, cleaning the house, picking up medicines, or just running them to the doctor. I love you all. I don't deserve you, but God is gracious to the unworthy. Grace and peace to you all. And postscript here, Romans 5:8, but God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Thank you, Rob. It did well. Did well. I want to share today a little bit. I know that we're looking at a family situation here, and I'm so grateful that God created family. You know, He didn't have to do it that way. He didn't have to do it the way He did. He gave us the ability to marry and to have children and to raise those children, create children, grandchildren, and people who are a close-knit group that care about each other, and I'm grateful. And we see that in the Scriptures, all over the Scriptures, and we see that Jesus was quite understanding about that, our love for our family. You know, there's a story in the book of John that I love very dearly, and I think really God put this story in the book of John for this very occasion, and that is the story of family. Jesus was close to a family that lived in Bethany, Mary and Martha and their brother Lazarus, and He went to eat with them many times. It seemed like, you know, Jesus kind of made Himself part of their family as He came through Bethany. Bethany's about a mile from Jerusalem, so when He was on His way to Jerusalem, a lot of times He would come by there and stop by and eat dinner with them. Now, for one thing, in those days, they didn't have any place to stop and eat. I mean, there wasn't any McDonald's or, you know, Pizza Hut, so they had to find out a way to feed themselves en route as they were going from one place to the other. And I'm sure they took bread and took lunches and whatever, but it was wonderful when you had somewhere you could stop by and get a meal.
And apparently this is one of those places that Jesus would do so. And when we see this family in the scriptures, we see them serving the disciples and his entourage of folks quite often. And we can get the personalities that jump off the page in the discussions that take place around their table or at their home. But this one event that took place is really so pointing for the issue of loss of loved ones. And this is kind of why I like to use this passage. You know, when Jesus was in a town about a mile and a half away from Bethany, this friend of his named Lazarus that Jesus was very close to got sick, and to the point of death sick. And these sisters didn't call the doctor. They didn't call a hospital. They didn't call, I mean, they had doctors in those days. Probably didn't have hospitals, but they had doctors. And they didn't call a doctor. They knew that Jesus wasn't far away, and they had seen him do all these wonderful things. And so they sent for him, but he didn't come. But he didn't come. For about 4 or 5 days, he didn't come. And it was quite frustrating for them because they felt like that they were close to Jesus and their family was close to Jesus, but he didn't come. And so they sent for somebody to come get him and tell Jesus, the one that you love is sick. And he said, okay, but he stayed away. And he let Lazarus die. And his disciples didn't even want to go back to Bethany, but they went with him when he decided to go. He got up one morning, he said, we're going back to Bethany. And they said, we don't need to go there. Last time we was there, they wanted to kill you. He said, we're going back to Bethany. And when he said that, they said, well, why? And he said, because Lazarus sleeps. And they said, we know he's sleeping, and that's good. He's sick. And he said, no, he's dead. And I want to point something out here. You know, Jesus never referred to one of his friends that had died, or anybody for that matter, in the past tense. Always referred to them as if they were still alive, because to him they were. You see, we don't die. We just change locations. We leave our body behind, but we change locations. You see, the fact that Lazarus had stepped out of his body, what to Jesus wasn't death. But he had to go back and remedy this issue. And so he went back, and when he got there, the two sisters were kind of mad at him. And you could tell it in what they said. You know, they ran out. Martha ran up out to him. She didn't let him get in the house or get in the yard. She met him in the driveway and said, you know, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. She was upset. And Jesus said to her some famous words. Your brother will rise again. She said, I know he'll rise again at the last day. You know, she knew about the resurrection to come, but she wanted him alive now. Apparently, he was a young man. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Now, I mean, those are some powerful statements. What happens to a person if they don't die? Those that believe in Jesus don't die, and they'll never die. Because death to God is separation from him. And he said, once you believe on me, you'll never be separated from me. That's a powerful thing to just grasp. That when our family members that are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ step away from us out of their first earthly body, they didn't die. They just left their earthly body. But they didn't leave Jesus. And Jesus tells his believers that they'll never be alone, that he'll never leave them, he'll never forsake them, so they didn't die. So Jesus is saying, he that believeth in me and he's dead, yet shall he live. Because there had been people who had died that did not, you know, before Jesus. He said, they'll live again, but those that believe in me will never die. If you're alive, you'll never die. And this woman said, you know, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, who cometh into the world. And when she said that, she went and got her sister. And she told Mary that Jesus was out there in the yard. And Jesus didn't go in the house to see her. He just stayed right there waiting on her. And she came out to see him. And when she got out there, she said the same thing. If you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died.
And Jesus didn't even try to reason with her. She's the emotional one of the sisters. He said, "Where is he? Where have you laid him?" And he knew, but he let them lead him to the grave of Lazarus. And on the way, Jesus even wept with them. Why do you think he wept? Because he hated to see them have to go through this pain. You see, there's a process that we're going through as human beings that is a process of life and accepting or rejecting Jesus. And then, of course, we step into heaven or we step into the depths of hell. And Jesus wept with them. And when they took him to where he was, and he told them to roll the stone back, and you know the story. He called Lazarus' name, and Lazarus came forth. He'd been in the grave 4 days, so Martha said. "Lord, you know, you're rolling the stone back. He's been in the grave 4 days. He'll stink." And Jesus said, "Roll the stone back." And they did. And, of course, Jesus called his name, and he came forth and alive, and he lived after that. Now, why do we have such a story as that? And John's the one that gave it to us. John told us about this story, the disciple John. I think on days like today, when we lose our loved ones, first of all, a lot of times we're expecting God to raise them up before they die. And he allowed Lazarus to die first. Then he raised him up. And this is a picture of what's going to happen to us all that truly know Jesus. I mean, we believe on him. We put our faith and trust that he is the Son of God, that he is the one who came to die for our sins, that he has the power to resurrect from the grave. He resurrected himself. And so those who believe on, as the Bible says, on the Lord Jesus Christ and what he came to do and that he accomplished it, put our faith and trust in him and that accomplishment, that we'll never die. Now, we'll step out of this body if he doesn't come before then. And we will go somewhere, and we will go, as he says here, as well as Paul says later, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So we know now if we step out of this body, we go directly to God. But we'll never be alone, and we'll never be away from God once we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Those are powerful things. Now, what we see in this and what we get in this picture here is, because Jesus, number one, Jesus and Lazarus were good friends. Matter of fact, Martha said to Jesus, "The one that you love is sick." He called him, "The one that you love is sick." And Jesus allowed this family to go through this so that you and me could be able to see what dying, with the earthly term, dying is all about if you love Jesus. And really, death to a Christian is a minor inconvenience. Death to a Christian is a minor inconvenience. Because Lazarus was dead in the grave for 4 days, and then Jesus resurrected him from the grave. Now, when we look into chapter 12, we see a big party going on at a man's house. Matter of fact, it was Judas Iscariot's daddy's house. And they're celebrating, and Lazarus sitting there eating dinner beside Jesus. And so we start this story with Lazarus sick, Lazarus dies, Jesus shows up, resurrects him from the dead, and then they're having a celebration and eating a meal together. What does that say for those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and are his friends? Death is a minor inconvenience. So today, I don't know where you are. I don't know most of you, but I encourage you to really take serious what the Bible talks about and what the Bible says, especially what he says about the Lord Jesus Christ. Because for those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. Saved from what? Saved from death. What is death to God? Separation from him. For those who believe on the Lord Jesus, put their faith and trust in what Jesus came to do and did do. And there's a time in our life when we do that, we become a spiritual birthed human being. We're born again into the kingdom of God, and therefore we have the precious promises that the Lord will never leave us, he'll never forsake us. And I mean, those are powerful things. And so we can look at Miss Nell and Mr. Robert here, and really, it's between them and God, really. Nell couldn't help Robert, and Robert really couldn't fix it for Nell. I mean, it had to be something they did personally themselves. I mean, that's a big issue as well. And they'll stand before God as individuals. But the reality is, if they put their trust in what Jesus came to do and did, and believe that he came to do it, and he did it, and he did it for them, and they have made him the Savior of their life, there'll be no death for Nell and Robert. There'll be only a change of zip code. I mean, they step out of their bodies, and they step into the kingdom of heaven. And so, you know, this is a powerful thing to think about. But this is what I want you to think about here today. It's wonderful. God has put these two together and gave them 52, apparently, pretty good years. And they lived at a good time to be an American. You know, I mean, Nell and Robert lived after World War II, during the Industrial Revolution age, the growth of America, the expansion of America, and I mean the explosion of technology in America. Think about what they lived through. I mean, they lived through when, you know, I mean, I'm almost as old as they are, or were, and I know we went through no television. Some of you can know what I'm talking about, to having a television, but you couldn't hardly see it. You know, you almost had to set chairs up. Corky, when she was young, they had a black and white television. They sat on the floor, her and her sister, with blankets up over chairs so they could see the picture if the sun was coming in the window. I mean, that was the beginning of television. And they were glad to have it at that time. Watching Leave It to Beaver and, you know, something along that line. It was great television in those days, but they couldn't hardly see it. And I remember the same thing, and I remember when we got our first colored television. I mean, it was really something to see color in that box. You remember that? And we had no phone. Remember that? No phone. I mean, somebody up the road might have had a phone, but you didn't have enough money to have no phone. And if you had it, you couldn't buy it because the lines didn't come down your way. Remember that? Then you got one. Boy, it was a great day when you got a phone. I don't remember our parents getting electricity. I don't go back that far, and they don't either. They probably had electricity when they was growing up. I don't know. But we had electricity. We had running water in the house. Corky didn't have running water. She had running water, but she didn't have a bathroom. And an outhouse. They came through this era where you're unspeakable today to even think about having an outhouse at your house. I mean, you put a house in now and say, well, I'm just going to build an outhouse in the backyard. We're not going to put in a septic tank. I mean, people think you're crazy. But that's the way it was. But we've come through so much. Then you got a telephone in your house, and it was a party line. And if you had two little ladies up the road that liked to gossip, then they kept it tied up all the time. And so, I mean, it was challenging. But, hey, nobody knew any better because everybody was in the same shape. And then, of course, you got your private line. You thought that was grand, but it only went so far. Anything outside of a certain area, it cost you a fortune to call anybody. I mean, it's really progressed. And then we went to cell phones, and we went to computers. Your mom and dad or your family member here experienced the best of America. I don't know if it's the best of America is ahead of us, but they had the best of America. They had a good marriage, from what I understand. They had a great family. They loved their family. And apparently you loved them. And they had good times with you, and God blessed them with whatever, you know, could be made with a family. And we lived in the greatest country on the planet. They were exposed to the message of Christ, and they lived a great time. So God really shined his grace upon Nell and Robert. And so let's just give thanks today that God birthed them in your life and birthed you into their world, as Robert already has written here, and he gave you a life with them, because everybody don't have a good dad and everybody don't have a good mom. Believe me, we deal with people all the time that don't have a good dad and mom, and you see it all the time. But you had that. You had good family members. You had good friends, and you had a great life. And so we just want to rejoice in that. But they've lived a legacy, but they also gave this new generation somebody to look at to say it can be done. Because in this country today, over 50% of marriages end up in divorce today and growing. Some of them don't even get married. They can't divorce if they're not married. And so really the reality is it's probably more like 70% don't stick together. Because a lot of them don't get married. They just change every 2 years. And you know this, and I know this. So but it can be done. And Nell and Robert showed, you know, you get married, you take those vows, you weather the storms together, and you take care of somebody when they're sick, and you minister to them, you care for them, and you be their best friend. I mean, this is what life's about. And you raise a great family, and you enjoy meals together, holidays together, and hopefully Jesus together. Amen? Now, if you don't know Jesus, I'll be around today. I'll be glad to talk to you. But I would just encourage you to go and take a walk by yourself and just say, God, you know, I don't know a lot, but I know enough to know that I need Jesus. And I believe that he died for me, and he rose out of the grave for me, and that I am so grateful that I know all that, because a lot of people in the world don't. And I'm asking you to forgive me and save me today. Wash me clean and give me the presence of the Holy Spirit. I challenge you to do that. But today, I want to have a word of prayer, and then I'm going to ask Jason to come and close us out with a song, and then we'll go have some lunch together. But, yep. I don't think so. I do not, sir. Kimberly had a statement? I don't have it, buddy. Kimberly want to make it? I'm sorry, but I don't. I don't know. Maybe she's supposed to make it in person.
I called Nell and Robert Grandma and Grandpa. And Grandma raised some loyal boys, faithful, loving to their wives. And she loved her grandkids. She loved her kids. And we're going to miss them. And Grandpa, he was feisty. And he loved everybody. And we're going to miss him as well.
Anyone else want to finish this off here today? Kimberly will be the finish today. We'll pray and then we'll ask Jason to come. Father, we thank you for this couple, for the legacy they left behind, for the life that they lived. And Lord, we thank you, Lord Father, from what I understand, they had a testimony, and I pray that they knew you. I didn't know them, so I can't say that, but I pray that they knew you. Lord, I pray that everyone listening today, even those that will listen to this tape that is being made, this recording that's being made, will without question know Jesus. But Lord, if we know Jesus, it was such a joy for Mary and Martha to be able to call on Jesus to come and help. And Lord, he didn't come when they thought he ought to come, but he came, and he came to make sure life was a part of Lazarus' future. We ask you, Father, to continue to do that. Pray for each and every one that's in this room and those that will even listen later, that, Lord, you will reach into their hearts and give them that holy unction that, Lord, it takes to come to you. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You got one?
Only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? or in all of you be still, will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel when I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still, will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel when I dance for you, Jesus? For in all of you be still, will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine. Forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Thank you, Jason. All right. We'll never forget, you'll never forget Neil and Robert. They'll always be with you. And praise the Lord, we've tried to honor them, and I'm grateful for their legacy. Amen. Father, we thank you for the celebration we've had today. We thank you for the family that's gathered on this Saturday morning because of this couple. We ask you, Father, to honor the food and the fellowship time. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You got this whole side of yourself, man. You did such a good job over there. He said.